All right, well, good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us tonight through our community forum, Monarch Butterflies, How Can You Help? I'm Kim Sembeck, Director of Guest Experience here at the museum, and I'll be your host this evening. An exciting part of my work here is overseeing our annual summer exhibit, Butterflies Alive. I hope we'll see you here on Memorial Day weekend for our grand opening. I've been working with butterflies since 2014, and it's been a wonderful privilege to work with them up close and watch our community engage with these really important pollinators. Each summer, our guests ask about monarch butterflies and have been impressed with how this species can be a gateway to learning about nature, science, and conservation. We like to think of our museum as a community space, and it's an honor for us host tonight's speakers and partners. We have a full agenda this evening and we'll begin momentarily. Please hold your questions until after the presentations. The speakers will be pre-signed to take your questions. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce Mayor Paula Perot, in the city, is the City of Goleta's first elected mayor. She has served on the City Council since 2010. During her time in public service at the City of Goleta, Mayor Perot has been a champion of the environment, public safety, and ensuring the woodland stays great for current and future generations. Under her leadership as a council member and now mayor, the City of Goleta has created a roadmap for environmentally sensitive stewardship of regionally important natural areas like Elwood Mesa. This roadmap is detailed in the City Council's adopted land management plans, such as the Community Wildfire Prevention Plan, the Creeks and Watershed Management Plan, and the Elwood Mesa Monarch Butterfly Management Plan. Paula?
Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Wow, a great crowd. The City of Goleta is honored to co-host this special event this evening with the Museum of Natural History. So thank you so much. And it's so wonderful to see all of you that turned out. It's great. We almost have a full room. As the mayor of Goleta, I value the special Elwood Mesa, but make the butterfly grow in our community, to our community. And as a grandmother whose grandson was supposed to be here with me tonight, he became ill. He is so fascinated with butterflies and he's so disappointed he can't be here. But as a grandmother and frequent visitor to the Monarch Butterfly Grove at Elwood, I know firsthand how special monarch butterflies are to people of all ages. It's almost like being in a dream to stand in the grove and look up and see all the fluttering monarch as they are preparing for their migration. It truly is an honor for Goleta. We are so lucky to have this in our backyard. And it's also important to realize that we have a shared responsibility to care for this unique ecosystem. I'd like to take a moment to recognize the efforts that saved Elwood Mesa from development over 20 years ago. Some of you are here tonight and were part of that incredible grassroots campaign. That vision, determination, financial commitment to saving Elwood will benefit generations. But we know that in today's complex and changing world, protecting land for conservation is just the beginning. Elwood is a living ecosystem with rare habitats and wildlife, and it's changing. It's impacted by drought and other large-scale changes seemingly out of our control. Despite these challenges, we are positioned, Goleta, to be a leader. We are positioning ourselves to be a leader in Western monarch butterfly conservation. Tonight, you're going to hear from scientists and our city Parks and Rec and Open Space Manager, George Thompson. We'll hear about the current state of the Western Monarch Butterfly and the overall decline in their numbers since 1980s. And that's not just in Elwood, it's from Marin County to northern Baja California. It's a critical situation that demands our full attention if we hope to help this iconic species. And for Goleta, it really is our icon. The monarch butterfly is featured on our city logo, but the monarch is more than just an icon for the city of Goleta. The monarch butterfly is part of our shared identity. The City Council of Goleta has prioritized the recovery of the Elwood Butterfly Grove, and we are committed to bringing the best available science to inform how we manage its critical habitat. I'd like to recognize my fellow City Council members, past and present, in the audience this evening. Mayor Pro Tem Kyle Richards. Council Member Stuart Cavden. Former Mayor Cynthia Brock. In 2019, the City Council of Goleta adopted the Monarch Butterfly Habitat Management Plan for Elwood Mesa. It's a roadmap that demonstrates our commitment to the monarch butterflies. And it is a testament to the many, many community members, environmental groups, regulatory agencies, and others that came together over many years to do what is best for the monarch butterflies. Tonight, you'll be hearing about the habitat enhancements proposed for the grove and how science and technology is used to bring positive change. This is an ambitious plan, and it matches the critical urgency and scale of the issue at hand. The butterfly grove at Elwood Mesa is nearly 90 acres, and it takes a lot of money to maintain and improve the habitat of that size. With that, I'd like to recognize several of our important grant funders that are committed to the Elwood Mesa. The California State Coastal Conservancy granted $3.9 million to begin improving monarch butterfly habitat at Elwood. The monarch butterfly population rely on coastal habitat, just like the one at Elwood Mesa, and we are very appreciative of the conservative support. So thank you to the contributors. Due to the drought, we also have a significant number of dead eucalyptus trees at Elwood. In the presentation tonight, you will see the level of tree die-off within the butterfly. I was amazed at the amount. I thought, surely this number can't be right. There are over 2,000 dead trees. This is both a huge decline in monarch habitat and a significant fire risk. Without additional grant funding from the California Department of Forestry and Fire Protection, the city of Goleta would not be as well positioned to address this issue. To CAL FIRE, we thank you for the $1.7 million in grant funding to address fire risks at the Butterfly Grove. We also have strong partnerships with local, state, and federal partners. I'd like to recognize several of our elected leaders in the audience this evening. From the city of Santa Barbara, we have Council Member Mike Jordan. Where are you, Mike? And we also, thank you for being here and supporting the Monarchs, so also the city of Goleta. And from Congressman Salud Park Hall staff, we have the District Director, Erica Reyes. Congressman Park Hall, strong advocate, has been a very strong advocate for the Monarch Butterflies. Just this year, Congressman Park Hall secured $10 million for millions federal funding to support monarch butterflies habitat throughout the nation. With that, I'd like to express my appreciation again for turning up tonight. I've only been given 2 minutes. I think I've run over, so I'll try and sum this up. There's one thing that I'd like you to take away from this, and that is Ellen is a community treasure. I think we can all agree on that. And it requires all of us to actively participate in the stewardship. As we move towards breaking ground on improving butterfly habitat, there is in the coming year, please consider being a volunteer. Volunteer in your time. You can be a butterfly docent, or you could plant a new tree, collect seeds, or get dirty and pull some weeds on our volunteer days. Finally, any way you can positively contribute to this monumental effort is to be so appreciated. It is a community treasure that needs the community to step up and help keep it a special place we all know and love. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Our first speaker tonight is Lindy Althouse. She is president of Althouse and Mead Incorporated, an environmental consulting firm in Castle Rovis that focuses on the conservation and restoration opportunities, especially in the wildland and urban areas. Lindy is a plant ecologist and historical scientist trained in entomology, who fell in love with monarchs and also with Dan Mead, a man who inspired many of us here today. 25 years ago, Lindy helped Dan survey monarch aggregations and self-published descriptions of monarch butterfly aggregations in the Santa Barbara County the following year. Lindy continues to be a key supporter of Dan and our team's habitat management plan for the City of Goleta's butterfly grove at El Elisa. Welcome, Lindy.
I am honored to provide an opportunity to talk about Dr. Dan Lopini, butterfly scientist and advocate extraordinaire for the City of Goleta's Elwood Mesa Grove. That butterfly grove on Elwood Mesa is something that Dan really took to heart. And during the time I knew Dan, he still went from round two, grade two, not very much because he wanted it fixed so bad. He started his butterfly career and his biology career right here in the Museum of Santa Barbara, now in natural history, working with Chuck Woodhouse and Paul Collins and others. We are here today to talk about modern butterflies and what we help. That was exactly the question I asked Dan in 1997, when the butterflies being at the Gabby of the Coast had so many butterflies on eucalyptus trees. Some were hanging over the bridge over Cemetery Canyon, and they were brushing the rolling stock, the trains, as they would go by. And I asked Dan, what can you do to protect the trains from the branches and protect the butterflies? Have you ever marveled at a butterfly in a garden, in the sunlight, by a flower? Have you ever marveled at the cluster of the butterflies open and dense and wondered, how do you do it like that? As Dan and I walked down into Cemetery Canyon, was surrounded by eucalyptus trees around a meadow that had hundreds of butterflies. Some were on basking on little drizzling pepper trees, some were on weeds, some were sipping the dew from the grass in the morning. Dan counted 80,000 butterflies, hanging some in dense clusters, some in a little bit less dense clusters in that butterfly grove, and it was absolutely magical. I fell in love with butterflies, and later I fell in love with Dan. As we gazed at that spectacle, Dan explained the cathedral effect that draws butterflies to a site like that. There was plenty of wind projection, from trees and hills in a canyon position that allowed the cold air to sink away, and a lovely gap right in the middle with that dew peppered grass and mornings for the water, shrubs for basking butterflies, and quiet air for the patrolling butterflies to lazily cruise around. It was magical. Dan Mead was a consummate scientist, a keen observer, a diligent record keeper, constantly learning, reading, and sharing his understanding with thousands. He started working on monarch butterflies in the early 1990s with Bill Calvert. He was an intern, and his job was to wake Bill up at 4:30 in the morning to go out and measure humidity and temperature at different places in the grove. In 2009, Dan published the Santa Barbara Monarch Butterfly Habitat Descriptions, and he continued to track monarch butterfly applications, especially on the Elwood Basin, and was often asked to consult on pest damage and drought in the Elwood Grove. And over 10 years ago, Dan started to help work on the habitat management plan that you heard Paula talk about for the Elwood Mesa, a plan that was just finished a few years ago. That monarch grove suffered severe loss over the last decade. And Dan and Stu Weiss here, I was one of our speakers, worked together with Stu's hemispherical photos to analyze changes in canopy gaps. They acquired LIDAR data to look at tree height and canopy cover. Kyle Nesson and Corbin Matley, Kyle's here to tell you about his work. They worked with Stu and Dan to model dead and down trees, wind dynamics. Ashley Fisher, who is here, actually worked as a butterfly intern with us. And Kara Spanderheide applied her decades of monarch aggregation observation to help us understand the effect of current conditions and how together we can restore habitat function and support the City of Goleta's monarch butterfly aggregation plans. Dan intended to see his project through to reestablishment of the monarch aggregation phenomenon in Elwood Mesa. Our team of scientists and collaborators here in the audience are really working hard and looking forward to fulfilling his legacy here in Goleta and the City of Santa Barbara and in the county and other aggregation sites in California. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Ashley Fisher. She is an endangered species conservation biologist. She earned her master's at Cal Poly University studying monarch overwintering ecology and now works at the Zoophilus Society for invertebrates conservation, working as an overwintering specialist on the endangered species team. Welcome, Ashley. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you guys for coming and hearing your talk today. I'm going to talk to you guys a little bit on overviewing overwintering monarch butterflies and significance of California disease. But first, I want to talk to you a little bit about the Zoo Society, the Amber Corp. We're a nonprofit and we have major programs focused on pollinator conservation, agricultural biodiversity, pesticide reduction, and more. My role, like they mentioned, is on the endangered species team, helping folks manage overwintering habitat and helping organize some research projects focusing on the overwintering habitat, which is what I'm here on this week. All right, so the population of North American monarch butterflies is roughly bifurcated in the east and west side of the Rockies. In the spring and summer, monarchs breed and occupy the mid to high latitudes of which are shown in areas in yellow and orange. Both spring and summer adults breed continuously, laying their eggs on the host plant milkweed. Their adult lifespan at this time is 2 to 6 weeks. However, monarchs of the species do not survive long-term freezes, and therefore they migrate as adults in part to avoid these temperatures. The migratory monarchs are those born in the last generation. As larvae, declining temperatures and photoperiod trigger physiological changes. They go into what we call reproductive diapause, which prevents them from maturing eggs or sperm when they first emerge as adults. They also have a higher fat or lipid content than summer monarchs, so they're a little bit chubbier. But both of these changes let them travel up to thousands of miles to their overwintering destinations, and they live 6 to 9 months, which is so much longer than those summer monarchs, which is pretty incredible. While eastern monarchs mostly overwinter in high elevation forests in Mexico, western monarchs overwinter on the California coast here. Circled in blue on the map below. So here's the general timeline for western monarchs in California overwintering groves. Migrant adults arrive on the coast in October and November and cluster together in groves of trees with seasonally adverse conditions until a form of mate and mating. It's generally believed cluster dissolution and breeding roughly begins in late January to early March, as warmer temperatures friendly to viable egg production return to the coast. This is when overwinter ends and the remigration of successive generations begin. Incredibly, it's not the same monarchs that are in your groves that end up back up in Canada. Those that continue the migration inland and northward, it takes up to 3 to 4 generations to reach Canada. Northernmost distribution. Zooming out a little bit more, so though overwintering occurs both on the west coast and in Mexico, there are some striking differences between the two locations that were wintering sites. For one, California's groves tend to be below 800 feet in elevation, and the vast majority of known sites are within a mile of the coast, like here's at Elwood. Whereas the Mexican overwinter groves are around 9,000 feet in elevation, away from the coast in the mountains of central Mexico. Moreover, there's only a little over a dozen Mexican overwintering sites, mostly in Guayaquil or Florida, but these are over the magnitude larger than the California sites. That being said, we have hundreds all the way up from Sonoma County or in the Baja, Mexico. So there are a lot more diffuse. And this is the same species, which is pretty interesting. But back to California overwintering groves. We consider an overwintering grove or site to be an area where trees, other vegetation, and topography, and sometimes including human-made structures, provide wind protection and other microclimate conditions that support monarch clustering and aggregations. So basically, monarchs overwinter in areas where it's not too cold that they will freeze, and it's not too hot that they'll burn up all their energy stores before spring returns. They also have trees that provide a substrate to cluster on and protection from a harsh storm winds and rain. A mix in sun, of sun and shade availability also allows them to be behaviorally thermoregulated, clustering together when it's cold and shady and sunny to warm up and fly when it's sunny. Other notable features often but not always include nearby freshwater and nectar sources. So these are some overwintering sites on the central coast. And these are some examples of sunny and nectaring and clustering. Considering there are so many sites up and down the coast, it makes sense that there is a lot of variation between them. This seems intuitive since the plant assemblages, climate, and topography in Sonoma and Santa Cruz are quite different from what we find down here and in San Diego. The wide range of habitat overwintering monarchs can be utilized and have utilized, including state beach parks, golf courses, and even native pine forests, just to name a few. Monarch overwintering sites cluster frequently on many different species. One of the most common species you will see monarchs clustering on, especially in Southern California, is a non-native bluegum eucalyptus. This is because it's very common and is often planted in groves near the coast. But there's actually a lot of variation in what monarchs will use to find what's available to them. They've also been seen clustering on red river gum eucalyptus, which is also non native. Pine species like hoary and Monterey pines. Redwood species like the California. And also Monterey cypress, California sycamore, and there are more, just to name a few. So it's pretty diverse and very often. They are found on a mix of many different species of trees, even in the same site, like this one shown in Willow Bay, where they're clustering on eucalyptus, which is not shown, but it is in the background, as well as the pines in the foreground. Willow Bay. But we track the population through time using the Western Monarch. It's a community science powered project that Josie runs annually. And this last year, we had 250 volunteers and over 267 populations, which is pretty incredible. But from the Western Monarch population counts, we know that unfortunately, we are in the midst of a long-term decline. As expected, there's variability in the estimated population size from year to year, which you can see in the green bar on this graph. It looks like the population is still unstable, except for the cataclysmic drop in 2019 and 2020.
when it dropped to 20 and then 2,000 in the entire state. While the recent count of about 350,000 seems like a return to normalcy, we're actually still in the midst of a long-term decline. In fact, a recent analysis has estimated the population has declined about 95% since the 1980s. Therefore, overwintering habitat is crucial to habitat. It's because a large proportion of the population is concentrated in a relatively small area for a big portion of the year. That makes it really important. Also, the first generation for the overwintering season is critical for the following year. They have to survive winter to lay eggs for the next generation to give. An elmwood is an example of crucial habitat in your own backyard. It's one of the most important sites in the state, and elmwood Maine, so just the part in the center right there, regularly ranks as the top 10 or the top 20 in our population counts in the entire state. That makes it pretty important. It's also part of a complex site, and it's one of the largest in the entire state. It's also a large undeveloped area on the coast, which if you've been paying attention to the housing situation, is pretty rare in California. And I would really, really like to thank all the members members of the local community here that were part of the historic Elwood Women's Walk. We would not have this land without you. We really appreciate it. But there are threats to this right now. Over the last 30 years, we've lost about 60 sites in the state, and this has been due to development, wildfire, and excessive trimming and removal of trees. We continue to lose sites every year, and a lot of this is due to a lack of awareness of the habitat value, knowing it even existed in the first place in some cases, and a lack of awareness of the existing legal protections. And on top of that, we're also dealing with the effects of climate change, like drought, storms, and wildfire. And Elwood is also subject to some of these threats. You guys have been suffering from a prolonged drought. I'm from the central coast of New San Luis Obispo. We've been suffering from the same one. And it's definitely making a huge effect on the canopy structure of these overwintering sites. Also, these trees are old and aging. A long time ago, and we're all suffering from a lot of storm damage in these groves. But there's a solution, and it's to protect and restore an overwintering. And it takes a whole village and a lot of different people to come together. Xerxes supports the entities and people that are collaborating to actively manage Elwood because it's such an important and historic site. The plans to replace standing dead trees and strategic replanting of trees is urgently necessary. So aside from supporting that plan, there are some other things you can do to help. First, you could volunteer. You could do that by helping us count the populations, and you could do that through the Western Monarch Count. You could also report all your observations just through your phone or to the monarchmonarchmonarchmonarch.org, and it helps scientists better understand where monarchs are and helps us better understand how to use their habitat and how to protect it. Also, you can create habitat in your own yard with a pesticide-free pollinator garden. Just like many other insects, insecticides are deadly to them, so you can be a source of nectar and food when they arrive here and right before they leave. And also, lastly, you can become a member of Xerxes and support a lot of the science and work that we're doing, not only for monarchs, but a lot of other invertebrates, including bumblebees, mussels, and fireflies. This is an example of the Western Monarch Milkweed map or how it works, but you can scan this code to get involved and look at some of the other community science projects and link you to that page. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you. Our next speaker, I'm a pretty big fan of. Paris Vanderheide is a senior biologist and monarch specialist at all across the meet. She has many years of experience creating monarch overwintering habitat management plans and for the Western Monarch and City Mountain Center for Rover County. Paris?
I'm going to talk to you about the monarchs at Ilva Mesa, how they used to habitat, how the Ilva monarchs relate to the Western population as a whole, and my goal is to show how the change in the monarchs' behavior at Ilva Mesa informs our understanding of habitat and the habitat quality of decline and the need for restorative action. So here we have Ilva Mesa. Move it, but we have six historic local engineering sites at Ilva Mesa. We have Sandpaper, Ilva North, Ilva West, Ilva Main, which is also the Goleta Butterfly Grove, Ilva East, and Ocean Meadows. So the city of Goleta has averages that count and survey the monarchs every 2 weeks through the wintering season, which is October through March. And in 2019, we started collecting detailed location data for these monarchs. So that's shows up in the covered dots for the last 4 years. And also in 2019, we did a site-wide survey for monarchs outside of the six historic locations and two new locations, which are Ilva Ironwork and Ilva Main Mines. So here's a graph of a typical season before this started changing. So the monarchs would arrive in October and ramp up to November, they would peak at Sandpiper and Ilva Main. And then by mid-December, they would leave Sandpiper and the population would peak at Ilva Main and stay at Ilva Main. And a few of the other sites of the East, and they would leave mid-February and depart for the beginning of the spring migration. Okay, so now we're really elevating monarchs to the Western monarch population as a whole. So I graphed it on logarithmic scale, and this logarithmic scale is really good for showing large numbers how they relate to each other. So the red is the Thanksgiving count data that we have for Ilva Main. The green is all the monarchs during Thanksgiving count in Santa Barbara County. The blue is the Western monarch population as a whole. So you can see in 1997 through here, 2013, their population is dipping and falling, but it's following a similar trend, right? The up lines and down lines are parallel. And so it's working. You can see a big, something happens here in 2014 where Ilva Main numbers start falling relative to the Western population. So that starts telling us something's happening with the habitat. Monarchs vote with suitable habitat with their presence. So when they leave, it tells us the habitat's not so suitable and it's not for sharing, giving them the protection that they need. Also, you can see here how drastic that decline in 2020s. And then markedly, they bounce even a little bit, not quite where it used to be. Okay, so here we have one of the years when the monarchs did a big change in their behavior. So in 2021, they were out of Ilva Main, which is the blue line, a bit, but they were in Ilva East so much more, and that's where their population peaked. And that tells us that they moved from Ilva Main to Ilva East. And that is when most of the trees were dying, there was left wing protection at Ilva Main. Better protection of the East, which is fantastic that Ilva has this variability in habitat so that the monarchs, they don't find it in one spot, they can find it somewhere else. So we want to improve Ilva Main so that they have more.
And then last year, as we remember, 80, we had some pretty significant storms. We had really strong wind events and storms. This made a big difference to the monarchs. They were back at opening, but only briefly. And they were gone when the storms hit in December and January, and this flushed them out completely. They were gone from the release after the big storms in January, whereas before they had stayed until mid-February, then they were gone by mid-January, so a full month before. So this tells us that the habitat did not function in the way it used to, and it's time for us to take some action. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to introduce Sue Weiss, PhD. He is the chief scientist at Pigside and Pigside Science. He has a wide-ranging research experience in conservation and population biology, microclimate characterization, and statistical analysis. He worked for over 15 years at the Center for Conservation Biology at Stanford University, has authored more than 25 scientific publications, and has served as principal investigator for more than 50 grant projects.
Okay, so I'm gonna talk about the forest structure and microclimates. So let's think like a monarch. We have this decentralized nervous system ganglion. And let's make up some rules of monarch. So if you like where you are right now, don't move. If you're uncomfortable, you're too hot, you're wind buffeted, too dry, you want nectar, it's time to mate. You get up and fly, if you can, when you can, because you need temperature and sunlight to be appropriate. Then the question is, where do you land? Well, where there are other monarchs, this is the best indication that's a good place to be a monarch. Butterfly, this attraction that they have for each other leads to what I call crowdsourcing the microclimate. Each monarch is making its own little decision, but in aggregate, they're really tracking that suitable envelope of microclimates. And this works at the scale of groves that monarchs will explore almost every grove along the California coast at some point. And they stick at certain groves. Spur storm comes through, they leave some groves, they stay at others. The monarchs that are flying by looking for a place to go, go, oh, there's a good place to be a monarch. Kind of like the popular bar on the street. And then the same thing kind of happens within a grove on branches, that this branch just suddenly got a puff of wind. They leave there, and then they're flying around. So they're going to land where the other monarchs are still hanging out. And it's this dynamic equilibrium of monarchs are entering, staying, and leaving the aggregations. And that's kind of the collective behavior leads to this fantastic phenomenon on the California coast. And the key word is they're incredibly opportunistic. They're incredibly opportunistic, taking advantage of all the eucalyptus and primarily eucalyptus trees that we planted along the coast, not to make monarch habitat, but they adopted it. So they're looking, as Ashley said, they're looking for mild temperatures, place that rarely freezes and not too warm, so they burn up their fat reserves. Protection from wind may be the single most important factor that's determining whether they stay in the area or not. So the wind has to be less than 5 miles per hour at ground level. This was worked on by Kingston Leon at Cal Poly back in the 1980s and 90s. You need sufficient but not too much direct sunlight. This allows thermoregulation. So a nice dap of light environment is really good for them. So this is all a function of the forest canopy. So I say there are good holes in the forest canopy that are letting in light. There are bad holes in the canopy that let in light. And we have to have this balance between having enough openness So the light gets in, but enough shelter so the wind is kept out. And have options and heterogeneous habitats. And really important, it's not tree species, it's the structure and the microclimate that structure is created. So I first got into monarchs. I applied this hemispherical photography. The 8mm lens mounted on a gimbal points straight up, gives a full 180-degree field of reduction in photo. We started doing the work here at Elwood, actually, and it got published in Conservation Biology in 1991. Here's me. I've been wading through a sea of poison oak at Andrew Valera State Park. Yeah, monarchs really seem to have adopted the eucalyptus toxicodendron plant community. So I've worked on monarchs since 1989. I started at Elwood, and then I actually met Dan back when he was waking up Bill Calvert at 4:30 in the morning. I'm currently working in more than 30 sites, and what I do primarily site assessments is basis for management. So this is one of the photos. I took at Elwood, Maine in 1990. You can see kind of a gap in the forest, sort of a cathedral effect. So we're getting pretty good wind shelter from around the edges, but we're getting light coming in at higher angles. And here's just a smattering of the sites I've worked at up and down. So I've sort of seen it all. And the diversity of sites, and it's actually referred to, is really quite incredible. So this is a hemispherical photograph. The center, directly overhead in the center, this is the horizon around the edge. This has bad holes in the canopy that are letting in wind. Here's another site, a lot denser. And this one I want to point out. Here's the good holes that lets in some sunlight here. Otherwise, this would be way too dark for monitors. You know, give you a couple hours of direct sun. So that's from below. Now we're looking down from above using this technique called LIDAR, which is basically laser mapping of the three-dimensional structure of the forest canopy. And Kyle is going to give you a little bit more on this coming up. But what this lets us do is look at the forest canopy in a three-dimensional glory. And here's a LIDAR image of Elwood, Maine from the southwest. If you can see blue through the forest canopy, you can see all the way to the forest floor. So that's a big hole in the canopy. This is what it looks like from below. So we're getting it from below, we're getting it from above. So we can map out a lot of characteristics of the forest canopy. And one thing to notice in here is see how much open space there is. These are all the dead standing trees that opened this up massively. Here's another site. Here's Elwood, Maine from the north. Here's Deborah Creek. Got this big gap right here. Here's at the creek. You see the big opening. So this is like you're standing where it says Elwood, Maine, and you're looking north. Seeing that big gap. Then we move into the forest, about 20 meters or so, and we suddenly have a lot more wind shelter from these trees right in here. But this is like a thin green line of wind shelter that is really at risk of further deterioration. So we had a 1 in 1,000 plus year drought, and we really need like major reconstructive surgery at Elwood with the loss of so many trees, opened up the canopy so much that you know the forest is really sick, dying of thirst. So now I'm going to hand it over to Kyle, who is hand it over.
We'll introduce Kyle.
Thank you. I'm a technical and research manager at
House and moving efforts and modeling the restructure of overwintering groves, relating wind dynamics within the monarch.
Okay, so I'm here to talk to you about some of the modeling work we've done to restore monarch habitat Elwood. And that conversation really begins with LIDAR. So like Stu brought it up, this three-dimensional glory that we can work with. Here is, let me back up. So LIDAR, if you're not familiar with it, it's a way to think about it, is really high resolution, three-dimensional information about a given area. And it's really commonly used in forestry applications. So we have a SNP, we have a SNP here of Elwood, Maine, sitting in the southwest. And we can see with this forest structure and heights on the machines and the shrubs. But where it really shines, its ability to not only see the upper surface of anything, but also see through the forest canopy into the mid-story of the ground. So this down here is a vertical slice through Elwood, like right up here. And you can start to see a lot of different features. You can see the ground, you see the gully, you can see the cathedral effect that we've been talking about a lot, this opening and the interior, and also individual trees. And so not only is this going to be a fun way to kind of look at Elwood in new ways, but a basis for which we can do a lot of analysis. One of the first things we did was identifying all the deadwood. Our collaborators, Andy Five, who collected the slider for us, also helped us categorize just that raw three-dimensional structure into named volumes or shapes. So we want to know, okay, where are the living trees? That's what this slide is right here. And more importantly, where is the dead wood? So as we have, where is it on the ground? This is dead down. And also, where's the dead standing? That's what we're really interested in. And all together, we have a really complete and interesting picture of Elwood that we can use for further analysis, we'll talk about in a second, but also just to help us get an idea of how big is this problem. We had, as Stu mentioned, a 1,000 year drought. You go hike out there and you see like there's a lot of dead trees, but how many? Well, we estimate about 40,000 square yards of dead material or 900 dump trucks. So this was definitely devastating for this time of time. Now, again, Stu mentioned that wind is an important factor in monarch habitat. And so now that we've collected this LIDAR data and we have a virtual copy of the forest in our computer, we can use wind simulation software to actually test the performance, like how well is Elwood, Maine attenuating or slowing down the wind to create suitable conditions for monarchs. So our model put, modeled the here's our existing conditions, and these are our results of a storm condition about 25 miles per hour. Red areas, these are wind speeds that are too fast. Yellow is marginal, where the monarchs will tolerate those wind speeds for a while, but they'll eventually leave. And then blue is what we're looking for. These are suitable, those wind speeds that are less than 5 miles per hour. And this region right here, this is the historical range where we see monarchs cluster. And you can see, like, it's not doing too well. It's mostly marginal, and there's this streak of blue around the viewing area where we, you know, can reliably find them. And so what we want to do is, like, now that we have this thing, we can start to play with it. We can say, what happens if we remove the deadwood? What happens if we digitally plant trees and allow them to grow? That's what this slide is here, where we, through many iterations, came up with a design and a restoration plan for Elwood, Maine, and got this one result. So this is the exact same conditions, 25 miles per hour, and you can see the overwintering region is now mostly in a favorable wind speed. And another advantage of this is we can play with our own designs abstractly. We don't need to put them in situ, we can just test the ideas in themselves. So this is our double windrow design. We used it widely across the site. Happy talking more about that at the table. But we use this to convince ourselves that yes, that these spacing for trees at these densities really do work and create for species. And all of this work and much more that I haven't touched here, like collapsed and condensed down into what we see here, the pre-planting plan. It's a series of recommendations We have zones here where we specify certain densities and species of trees to reconstruct this forest. So Elwood was originally planted by Elwood Cooper, and what we're proposing to do here is replant in these historic boundaries to restore that. And I just want to emphasize here that we recently went through this exercise because trees are our best tool for monarch conservation. And I don't need fancy graphics to convince you that trees just take a long time to grow. So what we wanted to do was really take our best understanding and the best tool we have available to us to propose a plan that maximizes the possibility that monarchs will continue to use Elwood and continue to thrive for many decades to come. So thank you.
Our final speaker presenter tonight is George Thompson. George is the manager of the City of Goleta Parks and Open Space Division. He oversees over 500 acres of public lands, including 16 developed parks and 14 open spaces. George attended UC Santa Barbara for undergraduate and graduate studies in ecology, evolution, and marine biology. He's a trained plant ecologist and botanist. In 2001, George moved to the island state of Tasmania, Australia, to study eucalyptus and marine habitat and to reconnect with his sad side of the family in Western Australia. George's first career position was at the Coal Oil Point Reserve Steward in 2000, working under Reserve Director Dr. Chris Sandoval, restoring native sand dunes, coastal sand scrub, and salt marsh habitat. Between 2002 and 2007, George worked as a staff biologist at UC Santa Barbara in the Museum of Systematics and Ecology, known as MEBER. During this time, he taught field classes and habitat restoration techniques and led large wetlands and campus natural areas. He is also the co-author of the first edition of the Popular Field Guide, Native Plants and Habitats of the UC Santa Barbara campus, and a chapter in the fairly esoteric He pulled a lot of weeds. In 2007, George moved to the City of Santa Barbara's Creek Division to oversee the Creek Invasive Plant Removal Program, design and construction of the Upper Lost Cedars Creek Restoration Project, and stewardship of the Aurora Borough Creek Restoration Project. 8 years later, George took the reins of the City of Santa Barbara's Parks and Recreation Department Capital Improvements Project Team. Engineers, biologists, and architects to transform some of Santa Barbara's most treasured public spaces. These include the renovation of Kids World, the popular wooden playground in Alameda Park, planning, master planning of Ortega Park and Dwight Murphy Field, design and permitting of the Thousand Steps renovation, and design and construction of the city's only off-leash dog area at McKinsey Park. Bringing his academic training and experience in the built and natural environments, George returned to the Goodlands in 2020 to lead the Parks and Open Spaces Division, including stewardship at Elwood Mesa and the Monarch Butterfly Grove.
Good evening. Thank you so much for showing up tonight. We're going to have a couple consistent themes in my discussion. One of them is new partnerships. And I'm so excited about the partnership between the museum here and the City of Goleta. I'll be mentioning a couple other partnerships between County Fire, UCSB, and the most important one, meeting new neighbors and potential volunteers, because you've seen we need a lot of help at Elwood. There's a lot of opportunities to help out over the next several years. Let's rewind the clock, though. This is the 1930s, an aerial photo of the Elwood Mesa. That yellow star is more or less Elwood Main, the focus of tonight's conversation. But I don't want to lose sight of the entire grove. The entire grove itself is important. It's referred to as the elder complex. So one of the things that Dr. Dan Mead, who, if you haven't caught on, passed away suddenly in November, he was really one of the leads of our science team trying to come up with solutions for what to do at Elwood. Dan described the perimeter of Elwood, these kind of long windrows, as the nets that catch migrating monarchs as they migrate out to the coast. And then over time, the days and weeks that follow, they come down and concentrate in these areas that Elwood made. So this is early 1936 or so. By this time, the grove was already about 60 years old. It was planted in the 1870s. And how many people have been to Elwood? Just about everywhere. Okay. So, as you know, you can probably find some landscape features on this photo to realize that it's changed a lot. We've seen the drought conditions, but other ways it's changed. Just the overall square footage, the acreage of Elwood is now down to about 90 acres. And so we've lost a lot of habitat. And so the habitat remains. We have really an urgency to make sure that it is truly the best habitat possible for monarchs and other species. So let's go back to some of the information that we're able to gather from our LIDAR work. This one is particularly striking. Kyle explained how we can model trees that we're proposing to plant, but we're also able to model trees that are there, live trees and obviously dead trees, which you see here in yellow. All of this is either down dead woody debris, large eucalyptus sticks, 80 to 100 feet long. And then we also have data that shows the number of standing dead trees. And as our Stanford trained scientists, Dr. Stu Weiss, has often mentioned in our team meetings, gravity is not going to stop. We have these large trees that are eventually going to fall that are standing dead trees. And so part of the responsibility on this project is to get those down in a safe, responsible way so that when we do plant new trees, they're not crushed by those dead trees. Let me pause just for a moment to say something about dead trees. They do provide critical, important habitat for other wildlife. And so, after this session, we do have an opportunity to go outside and talk more about what sorts of protections the city is putting in place to make sure that all of that habitat is not removed when they go in and remove dead wood. So this is a view from the ground. If you've been out to Elwood recently, you know what this looks like. It is, as I equated, a pickup game. If you recall, as a child, you may have played pickup sticks. That's what we have out there now, except they're not chopsticks, they're large mature trees. And so how do we go about actually doing this work of removing dead trees? Well, one of the things that we do is make sure that we are not taking broad brush strokes at our solution. We really need a detailed solution. And so our team actually went out and mapped the entire urban perimeter. And so you see all of these little squares, 1.7 miles of neighborhood, backyards back up to Elwood open space. And so our team actually went out, created these 100-foot grid squares, documented the type of vegetation in each of these grid squares, and actually created a prescription on what to do within each of these 100-foot grid squares. So, for example, we may look at 11D in purple right here. That's right next to an important overwintering aggregation site for monarch butterflies. And so we know, referring back to the previous speakers, that vegetation, even though it may be dead, still plays an important role in wind blocking protection for the aggregation sites. So we do have an opportunity to get down to a granular scale, create a prescription for each of these sites so that we are ensuring that we're not compromising important monarch butterfly habitat. Compare that to other areas in lighter shades where we do have the ability to reduce dead vegetation for fire protection. And then we did the same exercise within the grove itself. So each of these zones has a prescription now that we're proposing to do fuels management. Fuels meaning dead down trees, live standing trees, big piles of branches that have died in some cases years or decades ago. I just want to pause and mention one of our project partners in this. And I know our Santa Barbara County Fire Marshal, Rob Hazard, is here supporting the team. This is an ongoing relationship. The county fire provides fire protection for the city of Goleta. But we've taken it up a step, and I just want to acknowledge Farmer Hazard for his contributions to our team. We are looking at using some of the fire crews to do this work, removing the dead down wood. In an earlier presentation, you probably noticed a photo of people in blue hard hats. That's a state agency known as the California Conservation Corps, typically 18 to, I believe, 26-year-olds. That are looking for career guidance. They join the Conservation Corps, get hands-on experience, and then many of those folks go into professional firefighting, work with the Forest Service, go into parks and recreation careers. That's another partnership that we're developing with a state agency to do this work. Okay, let's go back to Elwood Main. We saw a lot of detailed modeling information. This is an artist rendering of Elwood Main. So let me describe and put together everything in one image. So we've got the Tabula opening here in the middle. This is really where most people go to see butterflies. And if you've been at Elwood, you most likely have been standing here in the viewing area, or perhaps across the drainage over here. You're looking up at that Tabula opening. And then, of course, we have the tall canopy trees, and then as mentioned, that double windrow planting scheme that Kyle talked about, that would be placed here, where we have the most potential to reduce wind speeds in the window opening here. And then as we move out into the grassland, the Pacific Ocean is out here at the beach and the mesa itself. We do have an opportunity to plant grasses, shrubs, native shrubs to provide nectaring opportunities for butterflies and other pollinators. Okay, so let's pick another look at Kyle's mapping here. You saw the hexagons, and now we're giving a full view of Elwood Mesa. And so, again, this is not the planting plan, but this is how our team has conceptualized this very large, complex area and really gotten down to a scale where we're able to actually map out mature tree canopies and lay it over this landscape. So we are proposing to plant three different species of eucalyptus. Two of them already occur on site. The most common one that most people associate with Elwood Mesa is the Tasmanian blue gum eucalyptus. In my intro, it was included that I moved to Tasmania for a year and saw blue gums. It's Tasmanian blue gum eucalyptus in its native habitat. Tasmania, as I'll talk about in a couple of slides, is a very wet place. And so the Tasmanian blue gum actually is better suited for wetter climates. It doesn't really do as well in these prolonged droughts that we're seeing and will continue to see. And so one of the things that we need to consider is how can we increase resilience of the grove in the face of climate change? We know that climate is changing, it's going to be hotter, drier. And so what other tools do we have in the toolbox to make sure that the next drought that hits doesn't decimate Elwood? And so one of the species that we're considering right now is another eucalyptus commonly called carry tree. And I'll describe it a little bit more, but this is a tree that is from Western Australia. It has a lot of similarities to blue gum eucalyptus. And then we have the red ironbark, which also currently exists at Elwood. So in summary, we've got a planting plan that is, at this point, guidance for when we do get on the ground. We know approximately how many trees are needed. We need to know that now, because you can't go down to your local nursery and buy, in most cases, enough trees that we need for this project. And let's take a look at this chart here. So eucalyptus versicolor, that's the carry tree. Eucalyptus globulus is the blue gum. And then eucalyptus ceteroxylon is that red ironbark. So what our team did was laid out the planting plan, counted the number of hexagons. That's what you see here, 732, broken down by species, created that lower estimate. And then we want to have a little bit of wiggle room there. So we bumped it up, I believe, about 5%. Yeah. So that's what you see here. And then we actually need to submit this plant order to someone that can grow trees. And so who is that? 807 trees. Who do you contact for them? So you can call up a commercial plant nursery and put in a special order. You can certainly do that. But these trees have a specific purpose. And so we need to ensure that the nursery that is growing them is not using systemic pesticides, spraying them with pesticides that remain on the leaf, and then when we plant them out, could potentially impact monarch butterflies. So who do you look to? One of the things that we have the benefit of is knowing one of the state's experts, world experts actually on eucalyptus. His name is Dr. Matt Ritter. He's a botany professor at Cal Poly. He runs the plant conservatory up there. He's got a wonderful teaching program for Cal Poly students where they actually get a hands-on experience growing plants in their nursery. And so we're actually developing another relationship, getting back to the relationship building, with Cal Poly. And so we're actually in negotiation right now to see if they can grow these trees. There's 100% certainty that they're not gonna be using pesticides. And so that's really valuable for us. The other great thing is there's an added benefit of education. So we're actually training people on how to grow plants. That's often missing in this technological world. And a little bit ironic to be used so much technology here. But it does come down actually, in most cases on a project like this, using your hands, because we're talking about living things. Okay, so let's jump back into blue gum versus carrier, these two different types of eucalyptus. So here we've got a comparison on the left here with blue gum eucalyptus, and then we went through this exercise to determine is carrier eucalyptus an appropriate tree to use at Elwood. I just want to focus in on a couple of different things. Mature height, 165 feet, 210 feet. So yes, it gets big. Big stature is what you need for that cathedral roof, that structure to support monarchs. Rapid growth rate, same growth rate as eucalyptus. We wanted improvements at Elwood yesterday, so we want to ensure that they can grow rapidly. But as the manager of a public open space, there's a couple of key things that jump out of me here. If we look at, let's say, water use, carrier tree has a lower water use than blue-gum eucalyptus. So that means we don't have to irrigate it as much in the future, and it's able to be a little bit more resilient in the face of drought. Another one that jumps out at me is, where is this? Branch strength right here. Medium weak versus medium. That is somewhat subjective, but it's indicative that the carrier tree actually has fewer limb drops. And as the manager of public open space, we've got thousands of people that walk through there every year. So branch drop, not only for monarchs, but also for recreation, is an important criteria. Okay, let's jump over to where these trees actually originate from. So I've mentioned Tasmania a couple of times. That is the home of the Tasmanian blue gum. This is their natural range here. So it does jump over the strait here to mainland Australia into Victoria, New South Wales. Tasmania is one of the coldest places I live. It's also one of the wettest places I live. And so when we transport trees that are adapted to this climate to drought prone Southern California, or for those of you that are sensitive to that term, Central California, we do see extreme die off during these prolonged droughts. And that's primarily because it comes from cold, wet places. Let's compare that to the carry tree, which comes from southwestern Australia. If we have any wine drinkers or thurpers here, this is the Margaret River region. And so this area is Mediterranean climate, just like Santa Barbara. A lot more similar to Santa Barbara and Goleta climate. Before we move on, let me just say one more thing about Tasmanian blue gums. Our intent here is not to replace blue gums with this new species of eucalyptus. In fact, there are so many blue gums there at Elwood that are actually propagating, meaning that they're sending up new seedlings, that our team has mapped a lot of the seedlings. We'll actually use those as part of the restoration design.
And so it's not a switch out of, so to speak, of eucalyptus species. Okay, let's leave eucalyptus behind and talk about natives. And I want to ask the question, why are we not planting native trees? Because we've got oaks, sycamores, cottonwoods, bay laurels, a whole variety of native trees that could, in fact, support monarchs. Well, the answer is we are planting hundreds of trees that are native, collected from elwood watersheds and grown out of the native plant nursery. But the thing about eucalyptus is they're incredibly fast growing. They're less dependent on growing right next to running water, like Devereux Creek. And so you don't have the option for native trees. Sycamores, you saw in Ashley's presentation, we do have Monarch cluster on sycamores. But there's a hitch there. Sycamores tend to lose their leaves during the winter. And so you don't have that wind protection. And so sycamores, you can check those off the list. Oak trees, yes. What kind of oak trees? And so we're going to do that. Bay laurels, yes. Evergreen, fairly good drought tolerance. So yes, you are going to plant those. So just know that we are going to plant new trees as well. What about the understory? So there's this, I'd say, a myth that's perpetuated in popular media that in the understory of eucalyptus forest, it's low diversity. There's not a lot of natives that grow there. You can find a lot of natives that are adapted to grow in those conditions. And we've done that as a team. We've mapped all the native plants at Elwood Mesa. And through the previous work that I've done, we actually have now a plant palette of about 60 different species that are going to be planted both in the understory of Elwood eucalyptus, as well as you go out towards the grassland. We've selected species that are adapted to full sunshine, drier conditions, and then during the spring months can actually provide a lot of flowers, and in those flowers is nectar. So before the monarchs start their spring migration into the fuel, they land on these flowering species, fuel up, and then edit them, set in this valley, and so on. The table here that I'm including is from the Thirsty Society. This is a general recommendation for species that are appropriate for monarch nectar plants throughout California. This is a guide for us, because what we're doing is actually being microsite specific. So actually selecting plants that are evolved to adapt to the specific climate at Elwood, and actually collecting those plants from existing populations in the area, growing those out of the nursery and bringing them back to Elwood. And so one of the things that we've done as a team is map out all of the different plant zones in the main grove and across the entire 90 acres. So this is Elwood Main again. Here's the drainage that comes down to Devereux Creek, which flows down to Devereux Slough. I'll talk a little bit about the bore block here, but that's essentially the plank to get across the Elwood Main system. So you can see that we've created these plant zones based on availability of water. So you've got Devereux Creek having its own zone. Down at the bottom of the drainage has its own zone, and then as you move up into the increasingly drier subsites, we have a plant prescription and a plant palette for each of those zones. And then as you move out on the mesa, of course, we have a different plant palette there that's more coastal sage growth and grass. Okay, getting to public access. So now we're switching more from the habitat issues and more public access. Elwood is loved, in some cases loved to death, literally. We have trees that have been trampled to death. The root zones are compacted. In this slide down here, you can see the existing plant boardwalk here. It spans Devereux Creek. A good part of this past winter, that was not accessible, like you see in the photo, underwater. Great to have all that rain. But this, as a public agency, we cannot come back and put a boardwalk in that is like this. We have to comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act, a federal legislation that makes these sorts of facilities accessible to all, especially those with disabilities. And so we are proposing to have a boardwalk in place of the old plant structure. I just want to touch on how this design got developed. So we've been hosting a series of public workshops, site tours over the last year and a half, mostly attended by folks that live in close proximity to Elwood or generally to be the residents. And so we came out with a design that had an 8-foot wide walking space. I'm responsible for maintenance out here, so I did have metal posts because it stands up a lot better long-term than wood. But we got a lot of feedback from the community. They really want to see Elwood remain natural. And in terms of built environment, we're talking about wood materials. The more that we can source on-site, the better. And structures that don't dominate the landscape. And so it went from 8.5 feet wide walking width down to now 5.5 feet wide. We're really trying to respond to public input in that sense. Okay, within the grove itself, we are proposing a couple improvements. This is the viewing area in the exact same spot as the current viewing area. Same general dimensions, but what we are proposing to do is we're gonna have a lot of logs on this site. And so this is a proper opportunity to reuse those logs. We'll saw the tops of them, make them a nice seating surface, create this little learning area for our docents and casual visitors. We sized it roughly for the size of an elementary school class. So roughly 30 people can sit at this viewing area. And then we have a mirror one across the drainage area. A couple other site elements to note here. We've got interpretive signage back here. So there's a number of topics that we're developing. Migration cycle. It blows my mind that it takes multiple generations for monarchs to make it from their inland summer areas to Elwood and other coastal sites. That is an important topic to explain to people. How do they know how to get here? You know, if your great, 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 great grandchildren need the roadmap, how does that get translated? And so that's an opportunity to explain that. A key element of the sign, just to go down to a minute level of detail, is we're placing this at the back of the learning area so that if you walk up and there's a class there and the sign was up at the front, you wouldn't have to stand in front of the whole classroom while they're trying to view these monarch butterflies. So I emphasize that because we've gone to a high level of detail in these plans to account for the user experience. And here's a better view up close of what that would look like. Again, all native materials sourced on site, the pathways all covered with wood chips, no concrete, and so we're trying to keep it as natural as possible. We realize that this is the experience of Elwood, and we don't want to come out the gates and change that. Okay, so we are preparing permit applications. We're envisioning a city council meeting this summer for the city council to review all of the proposed plans. And then the next step then is to go to the California Coastal Commission. We're in the coastal zone, and we need to get a permit from the Coastal Commission. So we don't anticipate that we'll be at the Coastal Commission until January, February of next year, and then hope to start construction. And again, I apologize for using that term, construction, at Elwood Mesa, but it is going to be a certain level of construction. As a user, you want to go out to Elwood and relax. You want to get away from the everyday of your job, city life, all of that. And so we're trying to toe that line between providing user experience, why people go there, with making these fundamental changes to the habitat that need to happen to improve butterfly habitat. So how are we going to get the word out about when construction is happening? When are we going to get the word out about all of the fuels management, the dead vegetation needs to get shipped up? And that portion of the project may start as early as this summer. And so as a user, a community member, no matter who you are, we're trying to provide the tools to get that information to you. So we've just updated our website. Please, if you have a moment in the coming weeks and months, go to our website. You'll see the detailed plans of the project. You'll get a glimpse of some more of the science that's gone into this. And then we also have frequently asked questions. And then our outreach team at the city does an incredible job about blasting everybody that signs up for e-news with regular updates. And so we're developing another tool for our website called the Data Dashboard, where it'll have basically daily updates on where we're working in the grove, what zones on that grid square map that I showed you that we're anticipating to be working in. So with that, I really appreciate everybody's attendance at this Monarch Butterfly Forum. With the number of folks that responded, we have confirmed that Monarch Butterflies are a huge interest to the community, and particularly at Elwood Mesa with the project that's being proposed. We know that there's a lot of interest and continue to have this dialogue with city staff and our community. We've got a bunch of project partners here that you've heard from, some that you haven't. We are going to do a Q&A, and then I just want to mention, if you are thinking that you want to leave now, just know that we're going to have tables set up down by the creek, and all of the presenters as well as additional project partners will be down at the creek to have one-on-one discussions, and I'll be here as long as you want to talk. Thank you.
We decided that we wanted to have a Q&A with you all outside. So thank you all to our presenters and our speakers. It felt really exciting on our side. The night is not done. We invite you all outside, as Rose was mentioning, for some snacks and beverages. But I also want to mention, you know, a lot of questions brought in beforehand. Thank you so much for sending those in when you were signing up. I encourage you to connect with Ashley of the Social Society and Sarah from the Santa Barbara Botanic Garden, who can answer so many of your questions about milkweed, where do I plant them, why do I need to plant it, am I in the right spot to do that? So thank you all. Please go enjoy some snacks and beverages, chat one-on-one with our presenters. Thank you very much.